Welcome to the Amgen Biotech Experience Program. My name is Alia Katarna, and I'm the site coordinator for ABE Massachusetts. Today, I will be discussing Laboratory 6. Laboratory 6 represents the final steps in the overall process of genetic engineering that would result in producing large quantities of the therapeutic protein of interest, isolated from other components of the bacterial cell. Although students carry out this process on a small scale, it is important to help them understand that industry would use large bioreactors to produce amounts sufficient for widespread medical treatments. In order to proceed with Laboratory 6, you have to start a bacterial culture using the E. coli cells from Laboratory 5 or with provided E. coli cells that have already been transformed with the plasmid. Here at the Massachusetts site, we suggest to teachers to pluck a colony from one of their plates from Laboratory 5. So similarly to Laboratory 5, we want to make sure that students adhere to the proper safety guidelines since we are continuing to use the bacterial E. coli cells. So we want to make sure that students have gloves on as well as their safety goggles. So in order to start that bacterial culture, teachers can take a sterile inoculation loop, get their arabinose plate, find a lovely pink colony. So these E. coli are expressing RFP. Pluck that E. coli up. And inoculate a flask of LB plus the antibiotic. Dispose of the loop properly. As I mentioned, the other option is to utilize already transformed bacterial cells in which you would dump 500 microliters of those cells into the same flask that has your LB plus your antibiotic. We suggest to teachers to grow this flask between 4 and 5 hours at 35 degrees Celsius, rotating at between 220 to 250 RPM. After 4 to 5 hours, then you want to add your arabinose. And this is incredibly crucial. If you were to add your arabinose to your flask as soon as you add your cells, you're going to stress the cells out, they're not going to grow, and they're definitely not going to express that RFP, which we want them to do. Allowing your cells to grow between 4 and 5 hours after the inoculation, before adding the arabinose, will ensure that they will turn on the RFP because they're not stressed out from the initial growth phase. Once you have your culture ready, it's going to grow overnight, so that the next day, you will most likely come back to your class and have a flask with RFP expressing E. coli. The key piece of equipment that you will receive in your kit for Laboratory 6 is your column. These guys are super finicky, but the important thing is that you make sure that they don't dry out and that they're upright. So you can see right now that I have my column on a column stand so that the resin beads are completely settled and packed nicely. If we were to tip them over, the beads would then move and that would be horrible for our lab. You'll also see that we don't have a lot of liquid, but we have just enough to keep this column hydrated. If for some reason you receive columns that have tipped over during transport or they aren't hydrated, don't worry about it. So the first thing you want to do is rehydrate your columns, and you could do so with using the CEB buffer that you'll receive. Secondly, you just want to make sure that you keep it upright. So as you can see, my column right now is on a ring stand. The resin beads have settled and they're pretty packed. But you can see there's about 1 to 2 millimeters of buffer at the top to keep this hydrated. This column is ready to go for Lab 6. The procedure for Laboratory 6 calls for an overnight lysis of the cells. If for some reason you're looking to speed up this process, there is a way. What you could do is take your cells, add your lysis buffer, vortex, let them sit, and freeze, then thaw these cells for 2 cycles. After that, your cells should be sufficiently lysed for you to move on to the column for the purification process of Laboratory 6. Let's talk about helpful hints, the good, the bad, the ugly, regarding Laboratory 6. So these columns, even though they're made out of plastic, they are incredibly delicate. So as I mentioned, you may get them either dehydrated or they may be tipped over. So it's really important for your students to make sure that their columns are upright and that they're hydrated. So one thing we see students do is when they're pipetting into their column, they pipette with a lot of force. So keep in mind, let's take a step back. This is Laboratory 6. Your students are pipetting experts right now, and they're super excited to pipette. So even though you tell them pipette slowly, they may not do so. So I'm just going to show you how some students may pipette their buffer. So ideally, when you're pipetting into a column, you want to pipette slowly because this white right here is actually made up of very, very, very tiny resin beads. So you want to pipette slowly so that you minimize the amount of resin beads that sort of jump up and get mixed with your solution. Like I mentioned, some students, they're pipetting gurus, and they want to pipette as fast as they can. This is a very slow lab. They need to have patience. But what you may see is if you go really fast, all those resin beads at the top layer puff up like a cloud. And now, unfortunately, that group must wait even more time for those beads to settle before they could add their next buffer. The other common mistake that we see, and I am guilty for doing this, is messing up the order in which the buffers are placed in the columns. So as you can see right here, these are my four buffers, and they all look the same. They all are transparent solutions. So there's no physical difference between these four besides the label. Even with the label, it gets really confusing for teachers and students alike because we're just using some letters. So we have BB, WB, EB, and CEB. And previously, students saw LYB for lysis buffer. So there are lots of Bs, lots of buffers. Having four buffers with different salt concentrations allows your students, now scientists, to push out proteins that they don't want, keeping the RFP locked onto the resin beads. Once all the other proteins are out of the solution, they could then use the EB buffer to elute that RFP protein off of the beads and collect it so that they have their purified protein. So I've taken my super tube, I've added 200 microliters of binding buffer, and now I'm going to pipette 400 microliters of this mixture to my column. So I'm going to pipette to the side, slowly, so that I don't disrupt the resin bed. And I'm going to open my column up. So one thing you may notice is that it's taking a long time for our solution to run through the column, and this happens. So we suggest to teachers before they do Laboratory 6, or the day of Laboratory 6, to look at all their columns and run down their solution so that there is between 1 to 2 milliliters of buffer on top of the resin. Unfortunately, you can't speed this process up, and this is actually on a small scale. Think about what big biotech companies like Amgen are doing. They're utilizing this same procedure for purification on a bigger level. There are columns the size of me and even bigger that exist. So we just need to be patient. We can see we already have a drip right now. So we have buffer moving through, and our RFP is still hanging out at the top. So we're going to allow the buffer to move through so that we have a few millimeters of solution at the top, and then we'll go ahead and add the next buffer. So we can see that the pink is starting to move onto the column, but it's still hanging out at the top. So now I'm going to add the next buffer, which is the elution buffer, again, slowly down the side, so as not to disturb the resin bed. And we'll start to see the pink band move down the column. So one thing that we see that happens during professional development as well as in classrooms is that the students will lose sight of their RFP. So it's important for them to keep their eyes on the prize, and that is this pink band. So right now this looks really good. We have a really bright pink band, but sometimes depending on your culture, your RFP may not be as bright. So we suggest to students and teachers to hold a white piece of paper or something that will allow them to see this pink band and have that pink band stand out some more. So already it's been a few seconds and we're seeing this pink move down the column. We see white resin beads at the top, white resin beads at the bottom, and our RFP band in the middle, but it's still moving slowly down. As we mentioned before, this process is mirrored in big biotech companies like Amgen. What they're doing with this lab is what biotechnologists do on a big scale. So have them think about, you know, okay, they're isolating RFP. What's the big deal? It's pink, it's pretty, but what could I do with that? Well, what does that actually mean? Think about RFP as a therapeutic protein. What would that mean? You've gone through this entire process, you've checked, you've done quality control, you've made a big batch of protein, and you're looking to isolate it to create a medicine or a therapeutic for someone. And so you want to make sure that what you've created, what you've cultured, and what you are purifying is exactly what you think it is. So we'll be able to check and see if this is our purified protein once we collect it, and we can throw those tubes onto a UV light box or a blue LED light. And we'll be able to see, in this case, a large fluorescence. If we see that fluorescence, we know that we've collected purified RFP. In regards to insulin and other therapeutics, it's very different, but we know here we have a visual confirmation that we have RFP. Some teachers give only one tube for collection. I, however, like to give my students a lot of flexibility. If they want to collect 10 tubes of what they think their purified protein is, then great. If they only want to collect one or two, also fine. What's great about that, the students who want to collect three or four or more, I have them label their tubes and put their tube underneath their column and collect what they think is RFP. Once they have their four plus tubes of their collection, we have them put those tubes on the light, and before we turn the light on, we have them guess which tube has the most purified protein. And sometimes they are able to figure it out because, you know, RFP is pink, and so their tubes of solution will have a pink tint, but sometimes not so much. And they're amazed when we turn the light on, the fluorescence just surprises them. So they may think it's tube one because they think they're getting all the pink, when in reality, it's tube three. So here is where the liquid goes, and now I see that that's pink. So now I could start collecting. All right, I can see that there's pink right above the stopcock. And I'm going to start collecting into my tube number one. It's important for students to keep an eye on the RFP. Not only that, but just understand what they're doing and why they're doing this in the first place. It's inevitable that this is not the first time that they're doing the ABE labs in class. This is laboratory six, so they've either spent a day, a week, 2 weeks. This could even be their third week doing these labs. And it all comes down to this moment, this very drop, yes. So, you know, that downtime is when it could be fostered to have amazing organic discussions about what biotechnology is and how it influences our life on an everyday basis, even if they're just waiting for a drop. Okay. So that's tube one. If I were a student, I would keep go to open my second tube and start collecting. And I can still see that there's pink on my column. There's pink above the stopcock. There's some pink below it as well. So I still have a good amount of purified protein to collect. But it's totally up to you and your student as to how much you collect. If you have one tube, you're fine, and you can put that on a light box and look at the fluorescence with that one tube. If you want to see an array of the fluorescence, you know, your first tube versus your second versus your third, I would suggest collecting three. Okay, I cheated with that one. But now I'm going to stop it. And one thing I've also been looking at is how much buffer is at the top. I don't want that buffer to move all the way down and to have my resin beads exposed to air. I want to keep those as hydrated as possible. So I'm stopping right here with about 1 to 2 millimeters of buffer at the top, which is what we started with. So that's okay. I will be adding a fourth buffer, the CEB buffer, to wash everything out and get this column ready for use again. So that's done. So I have two tubes. And now we're going to put these on our blue LED light. And we can see that the tubes are pretty pink. But once we turn the light on, we can see how bright they glow. Again, another wow factor. The plates are pretty wow, you know, because they plated something that was inherently transparent and it was bacteria that grew overnight. Not just did it grow, but it started to express something that they've never seen before. You know, they've heard about RFP, they've seen pictures of plasmids, pictures of the gene, but they didn't actually see it in action. This is purified protein. It encapsulates what the ABE program is all about. You've gone through this entire procedure for numerous days and numerous weeks, and you have this awesome, glow-in-the-dark, purified protein at your fingertips. Whether you're in ninth grade and taking freshman biology, or you're in 12th grade and taking AP biology, it's still pretty awesome. And that concludes Laboratory 6 and the Amgen Biotech Experience.